Well, good morning. What a wonderful, beautiful day, and it feels like fall out there. It's nice this morning, amen? All right, God has given us a wonderful day and another opportunity just to be in His house today, so what better day could there be, right? So it's such a blessing to see all of you guys here with us this morning. I pray that you guys would get a blessing, whatever God wants to show you this morning, that you would receive that. So just be open to whatever He tells you this morning, and hopefully He'll continue to work in our life like He has been. Amen? That's what we want Him to do. That's the outcome that we want every time we're in God's house. So I want to invite you. We're going to open in prayer. If you're able to stand, please stand. If you're not, that's fine. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we open up this service this morning, we just come before You kneeling at the foot of the cross to thank You for what You've done in our lives. Thank You for the opportunity we have just to be in Your presence again as a group. Lord, we thank You that You've given us this building and all the amenities that come with that. Lord, we know we don't deserve it. We don't have to have that to worship You, but You've chosen to give that to us. We thank You for our family and our friends that are with us today, Lord, as we get an opportunity to celebrate a longer weekend, to celebrate Memorial Day and what that means to us, Lord, the sacrifices that were made that come along with that. So we just ask You to descend upon us this morning into this service and just help us to feel Your presence. Help us to know that You're speaking directly to us. And then, more importantly, help us respond. Help us to be bold in our response and do those things You're calling us to do, Lord, starting today. We love You, we thank You, and we're looking so forward to celebrating with You in this service this morning. For in Your name we pray, amen. All right, you can be seated. Just look over our announcements real quick this morning. All right, a couple of things before I get to those. Making sure any of our visitors that are here, restrooms are right down the hall. If you need restrooms, they're right there. Children's church, we'll be doing children's church after our worship time, and the kids will be able to go downstairs for that. As far as offering goes, we haven't been able to go around and actually pass the plate. So for offering, if you have an offering you would like to offer up, the plate is in the foyer in the back. So you can, if you didn't do it on the way in, you can do it on the way out. Or if you go to BeulahBaptistOp.com, there's an offering tab online. Actually, you can click on there and donate as well. And as always, we broadcast live on Facebook Live, so we've got that service available there as well. All right, so as far as announcements, we have a church cleanup day coming. So that doesn't mean you've got a week to come up with some reason not to be here next Saturday, right? So we got to be planning, guys. Be planning to be here. We just want to do a little cleanup around the yard and inside upstairs, some rooms we got to clean out and stuff. So it shouldn't take too long, but if you're able to come, we would love to have some help. The more help we have, of course, the quicker it goes, amen? So if you guys can be here, starting around 8 o'clock, hopefully it won't take but a few hours. We'll get some things cleaned up around here and be on our way. We have a business meeting next Sunday as well. So if you can be here for that, all our church members be here for the business meeting, that would be great. VBS is starting on the 13th through the 17th. And then we've actually added in a fun day from 4 to 6 on the 12th, which is that Saturday before VBS. Then we're going to have some food and slides and a time for pre-registration. So it's going to be a great time. So bring the kids out. Bring some friends with your kids, right? And everybody come and have a good time. So that'll give us an opportunity to meet everybody before VBS starts. And that's always a great time. Yes, there will be a water slide. So wear swim trunks and bring a towel, right? And we're going to eat. We got to eat. So that's important. All right, so if we got water activities, games, and food, the kids, you guys are set, right? Some of us adults, if y'all want to bring your swimsuit, we will take pictures. Come on. Right? No, it's your Facebook Live for Toby going down the slide. All right, so he wasn't listening, but we're going to get him on there. All right, so and then we got Father's Day coming up on the 20th. So we're looking forward to all of these things that are going on. God continues to bless us and give us opportunities to serve and just be around each other. How many of you guys are glad we're able to be together again? Right? Something we take for granted, right? Look at this today. We got a bunch of pews filled up. It's just a blessing to see God working and doing things and allowing us to get back together. Just things that we take for granted, God has allowed us to rejoin and rekindle some of that stuff that we've had in the past. So it's awesome. I'm looking forward to what God's got today. Any other announcements that I missed? Oh, we do have, for those who are going through the Experiencing God study, we will be here today at 4. So if you're able to come back and be with us at 4, We'll go through our study for that, for the ones who had signed up for that. Otherwise, we'll have service time as normal at 6 o'clock. Any other announcements? Food Bank is the second Thursday of the month. We had some food boxes that came in this last week, and it's always a blessing when they bring us boxes. I didn't know they were coming. The lady who is over the food bank in Mobile called me like that Wednesday before and said, "Hey, just letting you know the boxes will be there tomorrow." I'm like, "Really?" Right? So we got some food boxes because the USDA provides some of the food boxes for free right now because of some of the government programs going on, so they allow us to have some free food boxes. So they brought us like 96 boxes of food, right? So we gave all of that out. And the blessing to me that comes out of that is when we get two pallets full of this food, a lot of people will come up and get it, and we get an opportunity to talk to people face-to-face and really get a chance to see what people's needs are and pray for them if they'll let us. But the extra blessing I get from that is the food boxes that are left that nobody picks up, we actually drive through town and we'll hand those out, just knocking on doors and handing food boxes out. It's amazing where when a pastor knocks on a door, sometimes they don't answer. I don't know if y'all know that or not. Right? It's like, oh no, I'm not getting sucked into that one, right? But when you're carrying a food box with you, everybody opens the door. Right? They're like, "What's he got, a box or something? What's he got?" Right? So they'll open the door, and I'm like, "Okay, I get to talk to you now." Right? So, but there's a lot of good conversations that have come out of that, being able to offer food boxes door to door, tell them who we are as a church, you know, just tell them that we love them, we're praying for them, and we're just trying to help meet needs. So it's great that we get to do that, and it's a blessing that God has given us that opportunity and opened those doors, right? All right, any other announcements? All right, I'll turn it over to you.
I know today is Memorial, or tomorrow is Memorial Day, and not Veterans Day, but I know it is a time to reflect on those who have served our country and lost their lives, but I want to reflect also on the ones who have served this country, period, and were willing to lay down their lives no matter what. It wasn't God's time for y'all, but thank you for your service and what you've done for our country. If you've served in the military, any branch, I want you to stand up for just a second. Let's give these a hand. Thank you. Y'all can be seated. Y'all can be seated. I think it's important to know the sacrifice made for this country. And the country was founded on God. It seems to have gotten away from that, but it was founded on God, and we pray that it continues to have a remnant left. So if y'all are able to stand, please do so, and let's worship the Lord this morning.
Seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Our God is marching on. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never sound retreat. He is lifting up the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free, while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Our God is marching on. He's coming like the glory of the morning on the wing. He is wisdom to the mighty. He is honor to the brave. So the world shall be his footstool and the
for just a second. Before we pray, I want to make sure that I include a time that we can give thanks to God. If anybody has anything they're thankful for, any prayer requests, anything you want to bring before the Lord so that we can pray for that this morning when we pray. Amen. We are proud to have everybody here today. Y'all look good today. Y'all are smiling and everything. Nobody looks like they're sleeping or sad. Yes. Yes. We are glad to have them here too. Anybody else this morning? Anybody? Anybody else? All right. Well, if you will you pray for us?
Heavenly Father, we thank you as we come into this time of thankfulness again, Lord. We're always asking you for things in our life, it seems like, but rarely do we get the occasion to be able to thank you for what you've already done. So we just want to do that right now, just thanking you for the family and friends that are around us, safe travels that they've had to this point, Lord, that you would continue that. That you would just continue to help us to fellowship with family that maybe we haven't seen in a while. Lord, using these opportunities that have been provided to us, Lord, through the freedoms that we have, through those who have lost their life as we celebrate Memorial Day, just thanking you for the men and women who were willing to sacrifice. Lord, it means so much to us to live in a country that's free, that we do take for granted sometimes, but we thank you for that. And we know it was provided by your hand. So we just ask you to be with us as we go through the rest of this service. And we're just thanking you, Lord, for who you are, as we should each and every day. First in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And y'all can stay seated on this and we'll continue in our worship. Go ahead.
Onward, Christian soldiers. Before Christ.
able to stand this morning, please do so and turn your attention to the monitors, and we'll continue on singing.
It is my hope and my prayer that everybody here could sing that song with feeling, could sing that song with the emotion of knowing God is your Father, of knowing that relationship that you've got with Him. If you don't, I hope before you leave today you have that opportunity and you would accept Him. I'm going to open a prayer for our children's church and let them go downstairs this morning. Heavenly Father, as we open this service up, this time of speaking your word and just proclaiming your truth, we pray for our little ones, Lord, as they go downstairs this morning, that the truth would still be the same to them, Lord, that you would reveal yourself in a real and a powerful way to them, just as you do to us. Lord, we love them and we thank them for coming here and just being a part of this service, Lord, and just having a willing heart to receive those things that you share, Lord, through the teachers that are downstairs. So please be with them as they go downstairs this morning and just continue to reveal your word and your promises to them, Lord. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. All right. If you have your Bibles this morning, we're going to be in the book of Matthew, chapter 8. The book of Matthew, chapter 8. And as we get into this morning, I'm going to do something a little different. I believe God really wants to do something. He really wants to move in this church. Are y'all with me? God really wants to move in this church. I believe He really wants to move in you. So as we get in our message today, I want to do something, like I said, just a little bit different. What I want to do is this. I want to share a story with you that we're going to talk about Jesus healing somebody. And then what I want to do is just take a step back, get out of the way, and I want to see what God does. All right? I just want to see what God does this morning, because it's not about me. It's not about the words I speak. This is about God speaking to you. So this morning, I just kind of want to do that, and we'll see what God does with it. But Jesus, what we're getting at today, the story we're talking about, Matthew 7 talks about the Sermon on the Mount. That's Jesus' most popular sermon and the biggest one that he had. And all the things that he discussed there, right? He had talked to so many people there, and he'd shared stories, and he talked about some things that the people had never heard before, and they didn't understand some of it to an extent, and then the ones who did really got it, and they wanted to follow God and follow Jesus and what he was telling them. So he'd finished telling the story, all the stories that he had on the Sermon on the Mount. And then what he did, he started coming down the hill, right? And as he was coming down the hill, there's still a lot of people around him. All the crowds were around him. And then that's where our text picks up in verse 1. And I just want to read three verses this morning. It says in verse 1, when he came down from the mountain, large crowds followed him. Right away a man with leprosy came up and knelt before him, saying, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Reaching out his hand, Jesus touched him, saying, I am willing, be made clean. Immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Amen. All right, God is so great in the things that he does. And even the simplest of stories that we see, and just in three verses here, we can see such a great story of what God did in somebody's life. And we see it and we say, okay, well, Jesus healed a lot of people. So this really, it's not a huge deal to see Jesus healing somebody, because that's what he did, right? He's the Son of God. He did that kind of thing. But when you really look at this story, He was healing a leper. Right? Leprosy today, okay, we call it Hansen's disease, and it's a little bit different. It's not what it used to be in biblical times. In biblical times, when somebody got leprosy, it was basically a death sentence. It was a death sentence, and they had to live their life out knowing that and understanding that. So understandably, there was a lot of time and effort that went into trying to avoid these people who were lepers. Because I don't want this in my life, right? Because I got a lot of life left to live, and I want to live it out. So I can't go around and be around these lepers and risk catching what they've got. Because while it's bad for them, I don't want it in my life. So that's basically the mindset of what most of the people had. So leprosy. Some of the things that I was reading even this morning on some of the things that leprosy has with it. And it starts with a numbing sensation to your fingers and your hands and your feet and your toes. to the point where you really can't feel the sensation of heat and cold and pain. So over time, when you've got leprosy, what happens is you start banging your hands and stuff on different things. Maybe you touch something hot and you didn't realize you touched it, and you wind up getting cuts and sores on your hands, and then those cuts and sores start to get infected, right? And then this spreads, and then the infection spreads throughout your body that you're dealing with. And then leprosy is to the point that it can even twist and mangle your bones, right? There's actually a claws disease that comes from that your fingers actually look like claws because your bones have bent to the point where they look like claws and they really can't use their hands anymore. And the disease can actually spread to your face, making your nose eventually fall off, and you start getting holes in the cheeks of your mouth because all the skin goes away and your ears start crumbling. And it's really horrible to have to think that you would have to deal with something like that. And you would have to go through a life like that. It could cause blindness. It could cause all kinds of things. That's just the physical side of this, right? Once the infections and the sores set in, can you imagine anybody wanting to sit around you? Anybody wanting to have anything to do with you? Anybody having a kind word to say to you? Right? There's just so much where people are going to stay away from you. And it was such a widely known disease back in the day that they had specific rules, right? Even in Leviticus, I believe it's Leviticus 3, it tells you, Levitical law tells you what to do if you encounter a leper. Not only if you encounter them, but if you are one, these are things you have to do. You're supposed to wear clothing that is torn, right? So that you can signify yourself as being somebody who has the disease so people would recognize you maybe from a distance. And I was even reading this morning that some of them would paint like a heart or something or a symbol on their chest so that somebody would have a visible sign of them coming and say, oh no, I got to go this way. I need to go around them. And they had to wear their hair down, right? They couldn't put their hair up. They had to wear their hair down. And there's so much about this that would be not just the physical, but can you imagine the emotional toll it would take on you if you had this disease in your life and you were completely shunned from society? And it also said that even distances, and get this, it says that you should remain 6 feet away from people. Y'all heard that lately? Okay, just saying. But you had to remain a distance away from people if you had this. And even to the point the Jewish Talmud said that if you were in an area where it was windy and you had leprosy, you had to maintain 150-foot distance from people. 150 feet, because they were scared the wind would carry it. They didn't really understand how it would contract it, so they wanted to cover their bases to make sure everything was taken care of. So they made sure they stayed away from each other. So to the point where they had to create their own little colonies to stay away from people, they would just stay to themselves. They would basically create a colony for lepers, stay there, and wait out death. Wait out death. That's a miserable existence when you get leprosy. The emotional, physical toll can't be imagined. And the more I studied this, I tried to put myself in their position. And I couldn't imagine being in that position. How many of us feel bad when somebody just doesn't like us? One person, right? We feel bad if somebody doesn't like us. Imagine if everybody didn't like you, not because of who you were or the kind of person you were, but just because you had a symbol or a mark on you of leprosy. They didn't want anything to do with you. They didn't care what your reasoning was. They just shunned you away, and you were out of society for good, and it caused a lifetime of suffering, both physically and emotionally. So here's Jesus. He's standing around, right? Coming down, these crowds are with him. And all of a sudden, what happens? This leper comes up to him, right? It says he approached him, right? And it says right away a man with leprosy came up and knelt before him. So he came up to them. Can you imagine how the people would have acted? If there were still crowds around Jesus, they probably were gasping and backing up, right? They could have been cursing at him. Some of them may have picked up stones and thrown at him. You need to get away. Get out of here. You shouldn't be around here, especially around Jesus. Get away. So there probably was some outpouring and outrage coming at this guy for even coming close to people and being around Jesus. So what I want to do today is just kind of talk about how do we come to Jesus? How do we come to Jesus? And I want to use this leper as an example of how we should come to Jesus. Right, so I want to use this, and I want to give you some understanding of how we should approach Jesus. All right, the leper, to start with, he came with confidence. I put confidence, but I also put out there desperation. When you get to a point in your life, and I want us to think about that, some of us who have come to Christ, we may have come out of desperation because we were in a place in our life where we had nowhere else to turn. We'd come to a point where we're hard-headed, we were going to handle things on our own, but now God has us in a position where we can't do it on our own, so the only place I can turn is to you, Jesus. This is the only place I can go. I have nobody else. The leper was the same way. He's like, I've lived my life like this to the point where nobody will have anything to do with me. I have no hope. There's no medical relief for me in sight. There's no medications I can take. There's no priest that's going to help me. Nobody's going to help me get cleansed, Lord. But maybe it's possibly because of what he heard on the Sermon on the Mount. Right? One of the points where Jesus was talking about, I believe it was back in verse 7 of chapter 7, he gave the pronunciation of asking, seeking, and knocking. Right? Ask and you shall receive, knock and it shall be given to you. Right? Or ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be open. Right? There you go. So he heard that possibly from a distance. And he said, you know what? This is my opportunity. This is my chance. I have to come with confidence. It doesn't matter what it costs me. I mean, because he's at a point in his life, right? When you realize all I'm facing is death or maybe there's a chance with Jesus, right? What do you got to lose? When you get to a point in your life where you realize I have nothing else in this world that can help me but Jesus. When you get to that point, brothers and sisters, you ain't got nothing else to lose, right? And that's where he was at. He had to come with confidence. And like I said, the people around him were probably being very discouraging because they didn't want him anywhere close to Jesus, right? So he must have had a clear understanding that Jesus was the only one around that could have helped him and there wasn't another way. Right? And that's so important for us to realize in our life because that's the starting point of coming to Christ. Amen? We have to realize there's no other way to heaven but through Christ. He had no other way of life except through Jesus Christ because possibly he had seen some things that Christ did and it just intuitively he knew that Jesus was the Lord and Savior, the Messiah. And he could come to him and ask him to help. So there's something else thinking about that I wanted to bring up too is I've noticed over the years that people who really don't care what other people think, those are usually the ones that get the most from God. Those are usually the ones that are used the most by God. Think about that for a minute. If I don't care what you think, I'm going to do what God wants me to do because God wants me to do it. I don't care what you think. They're going to get the most from their relationship with Christ. Right? Isn't that awesome that we can do that? The less we care what other people think, the more God's going to use us. The more God's going to bless our lives and be a part of our lives. That's what he was counting on. That's what this leper was counting on. All right, so there are times when people, they won't come to the altar. Right? Why don't we come to the altar? Well, because I'm worried about what people might think. I don't want to be the first one to the altar because what if they're making fun of me while I'm praying? Or we get these weird ideas in our head about what people are doing while we're praying at the altar. I don't care what people are doing while I'm at the altar. They should be here with me, right? That's what we should be thinking, right? I don't care what the people around me are thinking because God has called me to the altar to get something right with him. That's where I need to be. That's the attitude that we should have, right? We've got to come with confidence. We've got to come with confidence to the foot of the cross. We've got to come with confidence or even a little bit of desperation. If we're at that point in our life where we're desperate for an answer, we're desperate for God to work, I don't care what other people think. I'm coming to the altar, right? That's where we need to be. Number two, right? You notice he came with reverence, right? He came up to him quickly, and then he did what? He knelt before him, right? He knelt before him. So we don't really know how this leper knew that Jesus was worthy of worship, but we can assume, like we said before, he's probably heard of his works or heard of Jesus healing people, and he knew that he had to be the Messiah. So do you know that once we start lifting up praise to Jesus, right, who's sitting on the right hand of the throne, then that's when God is going to work. That's when God is going to work. Whenever we're praising him, the presence of the Lord fills this place, and then we see him working. When's the last time we really praised Christ? When's the last time we really come to him in reverence? Did we just come to church this morning to sit in a pew? Did we just come because maybe we were supposed to be here because it seemed like the right thing to do? Or do we come here this morning because we want to show Christ the reverence he deserves? Do Do we want to kneel before a holy God who we owe everything? He owes us nothing. And tell him how much we appreciate him for what he offers us when we know we don't deserve it. That's reverence. Is that what we have this morning? Are we just here because we're supposed to be here? All right, he's here with us even now. Whether you feel him or not, he's here. He's in the presence of this room with us. Right? The point that he works in everybody in here is going to be determined by how much we reverence him and praise him. How much we're willing to tune out the rest of this world and say, God, we're here for you today and only you. I don't care what anybody else thinks. I'm here to honor you today. When you do that, he can do amazing things in this body of believers. Amen? He can. Right, so then number three, he came with a submissive heart. He came with a submissive heart. He said, Lord, if you are willing. He knew he could do it, but he's asking, Lord, will you do it? If you're willing. He understood that while Jesus has the power to heal and do anything that he wants, that it has to be the right time and within the will of God to do it. How many of us know that there's times that we pray for things in our life that God doesn't give it to us? Amen? We're impatient. We want things now. We want things when we want them. We want them now. Right? Microwave society. We want it quickly. He understood. Look, I've dealt with this for a while. Can you imagine being a leper? Maybe he's had this for years. We don't know how long he's had it. But he's dealing with the pain and the suffering and the emotional outcast. And he comes to Jesus and he knows he can heal him now. But he doesn't demand, saying, God, I know you can do it. I need you to do it right now. He says, God, I'm kneeling before you. If the time is right, will you heal me? If the time is right, will you heal me? You see, Christ calls all of us to him at some point. Are we patient enough to hear him and know when it's our time? And know when it's God is saying, I need you to know that the timing has to be right. You see, anytime we offer an altar call, everybody doesn't come. You know why? Because maybe they already know Christ, or maybe the timing isn't right. I'm praying today that maybe the timing's right. Maybe Christ is ready to heal you. Maybe Christ is ready to cleanse you of sin and allow you an opportunity to go to heaven one day, right? To know him as your Lord and Savior. So I'm praying that's what happens. But he says, are you willing? God is willing, but it's not always the right time to answer your prayer. We have to be patient sometimes, right? I know there's many of us that have prayed for healing, physical healing. And we've prayed and we've prayed and we've prayed. And maybe God hasn't answered that prayer yet. But he's saying, look, now's not the time. Maybe God wants us to go through a certain amount of struggle to realize what we've got whenever God gives it to us. I don't know what the answer is. Right? But we know there had to have been times when Jesus walked past people who were lame and crippled and suffering, right? And I think about the man at the well who kept trying to get into the well and he couldn't ever get in there. And there had to have been many times where Jesus went through that city and probably saw this guy sitting around. He could have healed him the first time he saw him, but he didn't. Why? It wasn't his time, right? God wanted to use things for other reasons. It's not always about us. Even when it comes to healing us physically, or spiritually, it may not always be just about you. God may use that to bring somebody else to Christ. He may use it for his glory in a bigger way that we can't imagine. So we have to realize it's got to be God's timing, and we've got to wait on that timing. Don't get frustrated when God doesn't answer right away. Amen? We've got to realize he is willing. We've got to have a submissive heart to say, God, I'm waiting on your timing because I know you can do it. I'm just going to wait on you to do it. Right, I'm going to continue to lift up prayers and wait. Right, and then the last one here is he came with faith. All right, he came with faith. He said, "You can make me clean. You can make me clean." All right, so this is a direct correlation to what Jesus does to us when we don't know him personally. Right, when we don't know Jesus, we want him to make us clean. We need him to be come into our life and be a part of our life. So he can make us clean by cleansing the sin from our life. Now I want you to notice, right, at every instance when leprosy was mentioned in the Bible and somebody was cured of it was never, hey, he healed me. It was always, every instance you see, it's going to always say the person was cleansed. The person was clean. It always says clean. I want you to realize that's an image of the sin in our life, right? Well, I understand the disease of leprosy is a little different than the sin that we have in our life. The correlation is still there. We're dirty on the inside. We're disfigured just like a leper would be. We're disfigured on the inside because we're not clean. We're as far away from that as we can get as a person. Whether we want to believe we're good or not, we're not. Right? We've got sin in our life, and the only way to get it out is for us to take these steps and realize that we have to be submissive to God. We have to come to Him and ask Him to clean us and remove the sin from our life. That's the only way we can get rid of it. It's through the blood of Christ. It's through the blood of Christ. And He understood that, right? He came with faith. He said, "You can clean me." When's the last time we came before the foot of the cross and said, "God, I don't know if you can do this, but if you can, do you mind?" We should know God can do anything He wants to do, to include removing the sin from your life, to include helping you realize there is a purpose in your life, that you're not alone, that you're not messed up, that you're not an outcast, that God has a purpose for your life, and it starts at the foot of the cross by realizing Christ is a part of your life and He wants to save you. If you'll come to Him and allow Him to work in your life, I promise you things in your life won't be the same. You're going to be cleaned from the things that you've been facing, right? You're not going to be a different person or a better person. You're going to be a new creation, amen? You're going to be somebody totally different that only wants to live to serve Christ and do good things for Him in His kingdom because I don't really matter, right? God's already taken care of me. I've gotten way more than I deserve already. So I need to get myself out of the way, and I don't want to be a servant of Christ to do things for those around me. That's what it means. Can you imagine what that leper must have felt like once he received cleansing? Once he was able to stand up, and you can just imagine maybe the flesh coming back on his bones. That would be cool to see, right? His bones straightening out maybe from where they had been deformed and twisted. And then maybe he got his vision back if he was partially blind from this, because it does so much to you. And he was a whole person again, right? He was a whole person again. What would it be like in your life if you were a whole person again? If you didn't have to walk around with shame and dirt in your life, thinking I'm not worthy, I don't deserve anything in life, nobody loves me, I don't need to be here. Going from thinking like that to thinking, you know what? I'm loved by Jesus Christ and God, the creator of this world, who made me specifically for a purpose. And it starts now that He's cleaned me, and I can do some amazing things for Him that only I'm able to do, by the way. That's a great feeling. I'm praying that you guys would want to have that feeling in your life as well. The last part of this is He said, "You can make me clean." He said, "If you're willing, you can make me clean." And Jesus says, "I am willing." And He reached out, and He touched him, and He made him clean. Right? Jesus wants to clean you today. Can you imagine being a leper? Maybe you probably haven't had physical touch in years. Nobody wants to touch a leper, right? Jesus actually reached out and touched him. He felt the scars on him. He felt the imperfection. He knew the disease was in him. Do you know that Jesus does that in our life? He knows how much bad is in our life. He knows everything you've done. He knows you don't deserve anything He's willing to give you. But He loves you so much that He says, "I'm willing to touch you." Whatever's in your life, whatever's on your skin or your flesh or your clothing, it doesn't matter. I love you. Jesus didn't care what other people thought. Could you imagine what people were thinking? Not only when the leper came up and started talking, but when Jesus reached out and touched him. Can you imagine what the people around were thinking? I can't believe He did that. And the gossip probably started, but you know what? My Jesus didn't care. He doesn't care what anybody thinks about what's in your life. He loves you, and He wants to help you remove that and become somebody clean, somebody new. So my question today is, are you ready to be clean? All right, are you ready to be clean? Are you ready to see God do something great in your life? God has so much reserved for just you to do. But But it's got to start with you humbling yourself, you realizing the desperation and the need in your life for Jesus Christ. I know some of you are facing struggles. Some of you are facing challenges right now. Maybe you're still in depression from all the isolation we've had in the past. And that kind of gives you a taste of what a leper might have been through, amen? It's some of the isolation and desperation that he had. You may have that in your life today. So what I want to do is I'm just going to ask Haley to play some music, some background music for us. And I want to ask y'all to stand this morning, if you're able. Just stand with me, please. And something a little different. I just want all of you to close your eyes. Close your eyes. Think about what you've heard this morning. I don't want you to think about anybody else being around you. I don't want you to think about anybody coughing or moving or who. It's just you right now. It's you and God in this place this morning. What does your life look like? What does the sin in your life look like? How dirty are you on the inside? Music plays, I just want you to allow God to speak directly to you. Is Jesus calling you this morning to say, hey, you know what? I love you. Maybe you've strayed off. Maybe you're doing things in your own way right now. You're living your life on your own terms. You've gotten yourself dirty. You've gotten yourself into situations that may seem hard and you don't know how to get out of them, but you don't want to admit them to anybody else. You're scared of what people might think. Jesus is telling you right now, I don't care what other people think. I love you just the way you are, and I'm ready to help you. If that's you this morning, then you get an opportunity to come forward and just pray. Ask God to forgive you. Ask God to show you what your purpose in life is and how you can start things over fresh and new with your relationship with Him. Even more important, what if you're somebody here this morning and you know what, I was just visiting. I wasn't expecting all of this morning. Just a regular church service would have been fine. God's got you here for a reason. Maybe that reason today is because you've been running from a relationship with Christ. You've been living with sin in your life and filthiness in your soul to the point where you can't handle it anymore. And God's saying, today's the day that I've called you out. Today's the day I want you to get that right. I want you to receive me as your Lord and Savior. Even those listening online, if you're saying, you know what, I wasn't expecting to be listening to this morning, but it's caught my attention, and now I've listened to all of this, and I know Jesus is calling me, what do I do? I want you to kneel down before Holy God and ask Him to forgive you. Tell Him you've got sin in your life, but you're willing to trust Him as your Lord and Savior. Ask Him to remove that sin from your life and to be your master, to be your king. And watch Him work in your life and do things in your life you never thought you could do. So I just want to ask you this morning, whatever God's doing, I'm just going to let the music play for a little bit. Like I said, I want to see what God wants to do in your life this morning. It's not about me or anything else. It's not about people listening around you. This is directly between you and God, because that's the only two that matter right now. What are you willing to do with Jesus Christ this morning? The altars are open if you want to come and pray. If you need me to pray with you, I'd be willing to. But just come now if you need to come. Working and you need to come, don't be afraid to step out and just walk down this aisle. I promise you, the reward you get from coming to the altar and getting things right with God's more than anything you're going to feel by other people looking at you. have an amazing God, guys. We have an amazing God that can do anything in our lives. If you felt God calling you this morning, you didn't come, please allow him to keep working in your life. Right? Let him break through that barrier that's holding you back. And he'll do some great things in your life. For those who did want to pray and did receive him, I'm just praying that God just would continue to work in your life and continue to use you. Right? And we're here as a church family to help you guys as well. Before we close, let me get Cam up here. All right, Cam, I kind of forced him into this morning, I guess, but he's our new youth minister here, and we told him we need him to come forward to be a member of the church, right? Right. So, all right. So we just want to make sure we formally do that. So, all in favor of Cam being a member of the church, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Nobody. Hey, everybody likes you still. All right. All right. So, if y'all get a chance, if you haven't already welcomed Cam, just welcome him to our church family. All right. So. We're going to close in prayer then, and we'll let you guys be dismissed. Yeah, you can stay right there. You're fine. You don't want to stand up front with me? Okay. All right, you guys, we're going to pray and be dismissed. If you're in our Experiencing God class that we've already started, then we'll be back here at 4. If not, we'll see you guys at 6 o'clock tonight. All right? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this morning. I'm amazed at your presence with us, Lord. We don't deserve it. We don't deserve you to be in our presence. We're so thankful that you choose to do it. You choose to work in our lives and use us in a mighty way. I'm just praying that you continue to convict those, Lord, that maybe they're dealing with things in their life. They don't know how to come to you yet. That you would just continue to work in their life until they do. Lord, don't give up. You never do, but please don't give up on them. I pray that you just be with us as we dismiss. Just continue to bless this church as a whole. Lord, help us to go out and try to share the word and the love of Christ with those around us, Lord, because that's what we should be doing, Lord. It's not about us. It's all about you. We love you and we thank you, Lord. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you all for being here this morning.